eventful year for women, huh? In 2018, we all felt the seismic shift in Hollywood and pop culture, and we continue to honor those women, those superheroes, who bravely spoke out against the ugliest of villains. Yeah, that's right. It's a challenging and an exciting time to be a woman working in Hollywood. So what is it like to tear down institutionalized sexism? What's it like to take the lead in front of and behind and beyond the camera? And finally, what is it like to kick so much ass? I can't think of five more amazing women to answer those questions. Let's welcome them now. She schools her parents daily and never gives up on her friends. I kind of think she is the hero of Riverdale. Welcome, Camila Mendes. On Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., she plays an inhuman who possesses incredible humanity. We'll also soon see her join with her sister superheroes on Marvel Rising. Please welcome Chloe Bennet. Next, you'll see her in The Darkest Minds and the much anticipated The Hate U Give. Welcome, Amandla Stenberg. When you see her name on a project, it's an instant season pass. She just got nominated for her fourth Emmy a few weeks ago for 7 Seconds. She's reteaming with her Leftovers creator, Damon Lindelof, for Watchmen. Welcome, Regina King. Are there any fans of Two-Hearted Aliens from the planet Gallifrey out there? Oh, you're here. You show up. You showed up. I can't think of anyone more brilliant, as her character might say, to play the 13th Doctor. Welcome, Jodie Whittaker. What an honor to be here with these women. I'm so excited. I think since you are people who you are inspiring so many others right now, I'm wondering, when you were growing up or getting into this industry, was there one or two ass-kicking characters who really spoke to you, who inspired you?
The thing that is exciting for us, if I can speak for everyone, is that now we potentially look like the people we were inspired by when we were looking up, because all the parts I wanted to play were played by men. So if I wanted to be the hero, I had to just stand and clap at the side. So now, I think those parts we can see ourselves in, but I think, as I'm a bit older than a couple of you, but in the 80s, I was certainly watching the roles that I don't really want to stand there and wave. I want to be in the mist, kicking and screaming and taking everyone down.
Yeah. How about the rest of you?
I have to be honest, I was, like she said, there weren't many that looked like me that were kicking ass, but the ones that didn't look like me that I just was such a fan of, I was a Linda Carter Wonder Woman fan. I mean, I was born in 71, so the lasso to make you tell the truth. I was that person that I didn't really follow comic books, sorry, but if it was made into a TV show or a movie, I was there for it. And Wonder Woman was kind of like the only person that, even though she had on something skimpy, she still didn't feel like she was being objectified in any way. So yeah, Wonder Woman.
Probably the characters that I could identify with most when I was a kid were Raven Simone. Shout out to Raven. I remember identifying with Penny and the Proud Family. I remember identifying with Kiki Palmer and Akilah the Bee. I think that I always knew that there was a lack of representation of girls who look like me though, and so I crave that even more, and I crave more of a nuance, and I think now is the first time that we're receiving those characters.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. I grew up with six brothers, so my goal was never to be a princess. I never identified with that. I always wanted to kick ass. I mean, truly. So, I mean, I loved Mulan. Really, I really loved Mulan. And now I work with her every day, so that's crazy. Yeah, yeah.
My answer, I feel like, is really lame. I don't know that she's kicking ass, but I was obsessed with Summer Roberts in the OC. Because, I mean, but I think it's mostly because, I mean, she wasn't kicking ass, but she's a character who spoke her mind very often and was kind of fearless. And honestly, it was like the closest thing I could find to like a Latina actress, even though she's not Latina. She has brown hair and a little tan. But I didn't really have, I feel like there weren't that many Latina women that I had to look up to when I was younger.
Yeah. Speaking of inspiring, Jodie, I want to start with you. I'm sure by now you've seen that video that went viral of the girl finding out that the next doctor would be a woman. And I'm wondering, was there a moment where you looked in the mirror and you were like, oh my God, like, I'm it, I'm the next doctor.
I think the fan reaction is the most emotional part of this, because you know, it's all good and well, your kind of co-workers going, oh, I'm really pleased for you. But if you see an unself-conscious, like, wonderful little girl seeing something for the first time and being delighted by it, and then sharing it online, she's called Wednesday, which is the coolest name ever. Mm-hmm. So from one cool little kid to be pleased that I'm in this role, then it's really moving, because we want to inspire, but we also want to go, look, little guys, you know, you can look up to women. We're all right. We're not that scary. We can do all the same things, and sometimes a bit more.
Yep.
And, so yes, I think it's that the fan reaction being also young guys, and you know, I think for all of us being here, it's amazing to see so many people celebrate your work in their cosplay and their like love of the shows and the films, and you know, that's why you do it. That's why you work.
I agree. As wonderful it is for young women to see people that look like them, that have the same body type as them on screen, it's equally as important for young men to be able to identify themselves in women, because women, we've been doing this forever, yeah. And it will validate the equality for young boys that they go, oh, I see that in a woman, and then they will see themselves as more equal rather than thinking that they're better.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just said I think it creates empathy. I mean, like, we as women and people of color have to over and over again learn how to cross-identify with people that we don't look like, and what that instills in us is a sense of empathy for the world, and white males don't have to do that nearly as often. And so I think about the power of when white men are forced to actually cross over areas of self and conceptions of self and put themselves into the shoes of someone whose experience they don't have to contemplate, it creates empathy in them. That's what we need right now.
Yeah. I mean, Amandla, I want to just follow up on that. So many of us can't wait to see The Hate U Give, which is an incredibly and unfortunately topical story about brutality and systemic racism. And your character, Star, is about finding her voice. And even hearing you speak out, you have such a strong voice and such an inspiring voice, as all of you do here up on this panel. And I'm wondering, for all of you, was there a moment where you feel like, I got it, like, I found my voice in this day, whether it was, you know, on a job or just in your life?
I think it's a continual process. Yeah. I don't think it's one day that you wake up and you're like, yeah, I got this, and then you're good. Like, I think it takes constant self-validation, self-reassurance. You're faced with so many different obstacles. But I think definitely being in a position where I know I'm entering a workspace in which the institution doesn't have my best interests in mind, it forces me to think of myself as strong in order to know that I'm infiltrating a space from which historically I haven't belonged in.
I feel like I was really hesitant coming into this industry to like speak out on anything. Because you'll get so scared that like anything you say is gonna be used against you in the media. But then
and also women are taught over and over, just keep quiet and be grateful.
Exactly, and the more you speak out, the bigger the bitch. But then I realized like, I mean, with like the growing social media world and like your following really shows you just how many people look up to you, and then you realize you have this responsibility, and you know, now you can see your statistics on Instagram, you can see the age range and the gender, and I feel like I'm looking at a lot of young women who are following me and seeing me as this role model, and I feel like that's something you have to take responsibility for, because you have the power to spread a positive message and to make a difference in these people's lives, and like I didn't have that when I was growing up as a teenager, so I feel like it's very important to use that.
There's a point where it's kind of hard to ignore. Like what you're literally seeing, you're directly connecting with fans and with people. And I don't feel like I ever have it. I don't think I'll ever feel like I ever have it. But I think what grounds me is, as long as I stay authentic and brave to what I'm saying, even at the moment. Because sometimes I don't, you know, I'll say something and it's true in that moment, and then it cannot be true in another year. But as it's authentic and brave to what I'm feeling and how I feel about that time, I think that's all you can really do.
I mean, it's, you know, Regina and Jodie, like there was no like I feel like when I was, you know, becoming a feminist and sort of realizing that about myself, there was no like Instagram likes or whatever.
Yeah,
that's
the pressure, I think, is that for all of us, we can, you know, sit and be passionate, and one comma difference in the way someone quotes you can mean a completely different thing, and it's tattooed in the atmosphere forever, and you are kind of you've said this thing, and you're like, okay, well the context of this thing was not necessarily that, and that should have been a full stop, and then that was the start of another sentence. And I said the other day, you know, women are not a genre, and I think it was written down as, you know, women are a genre. And I was like, so it's like, not. It's missing. And I think we want to speak out, and we do, and we're in a wonderful position where we can, but then the world is, anything you said is immediate now, and to you fear your own censorship, I do. I certainly fear my own censorship sometimes, and I could say more, and do I always be front-footed with that, and I hope I do, and I hope I do going forward, but I know I certainly have been guilty of going, I don't, because I don't quite know how that's going to translate, which, I mean, I've said it out loud now, so I've got to stop doing that. So, you know, this is a wonderful moment, because I'm going to stop doing that.
I mean, I think, as Amandla said, that the thing that you discover is that you're always growing. You know, there's like, when you grow up, we're always growing. I mean, God willing, you're always learning. And I think I think it's a little more difficult for you guys because of social media. You know, as even though it allows you to reach more people, you're under a spotlight that is not always honest. And as you said, Chloe, like walking in your truth. And even though some days you may feel really wholeheartedly about something and it'll change in a couple of years, when you change that, someone pulls up that tweet that you put up 2 years ago and throws it in your face. And then for some, stop walking in their truth or stop being a beacon for others. And I think it's difficult. I'm not on social media probably as much as some, because sometimes I feel like there's a lot of noise out there. And I feel like growing up, while we didn't have as many examples, we didn't have to deal with judgment on such a huge level.
Right.
You know, and it can be terrifying. I love you to death, because you put it out there, and you're so honest, and you own it, and you're empowering for my generation, you know. And it's not easy being out there and in the public's eye. Mm-hmm. So So keep growing.
Yeah, I mean, I have to say, Amandla, when I met you, I was like, you inspire me. I mean, I'm 8,000 years older than you, you know, but you speak out about feminism and representation and gender identity and sexuality with such honesty, and it's so important. What has been the feedback? I mean, I think there's clearly like a downside to social media, but I think that at least from what I've seen with you, there's such an embrace of because of that. But I'm curious what it's been like what you've heard from fans.
I mean, I think I've received a lot of support and I've been so grateful for it. I recognize how important a culture of accountability is in terms of moving forward and not letting people get away with doing things that are harmful, racist, sexist, transphobic, whatever it may be. But I do think that the call-out culture has gotten to a place where it makes me sad that it makes people afraid to have conversations or ask questions. And that is definitely disappointing. And sometimes I do find myself in a place of feeling disheartened or quieted because of that call-out culture that we're now existing in. But at the same time, I think it's human tendency to fixate so much more on negativity and criticism than support. And at the end of the day, I think there is much more support than there is criticism. And it's more important to me to make people feel less alone in their identities and know that there is a representation of them that exists out there and is allowed to be public facing, than it is to focus on whatever hate or criticism I may face. And I'm also grateful for the culture of accountability because it forces me to be self-reflective.
It's hard, isn't it? Because like often with stuff anywhere, hate has the loudest voice, and that's when, you know, for things like the power of social media can just, at least everyone can come together and be a united voice. And, you know, it can be like an inclusion of, we hear that, but this is absolutely not the fault of everyone.
Mm-hmm.
And I suppose it's just, like you say, remembering that you're trying not to hear the negative and actually that there's much more support than there is not support, but it's just sometimes hard to hear it.
Yeah. I mean, Chloe, I'm thinking about an Instagram post you did that, you know, I think where you wrote about, oh, hey, by the way, I go by a different last name because I wasn't getting cast with the last name Wang. So this is what I did, and people need to know that. Was that something that you had been planning? Was that sort of an impromptu, like, I want to get this out?
No. I mean, it was just something where when I first, I mean, it's crazy because I've been in LA for 9 years, and when I was first auditioning, you know, it was the Asian roles, and then it was the white roles, and then they'd be like, oh, this is for an Asian character, and I go, no, I'm Chinese, I'm half Chinese, and they'd be like, well, you don't look it, and I go, okay, but I am, and okay, and then for the white roles, they were like, you're just not white enough to be the lead for this, like, but you really have like a leading lady personality for an Asian. Like, that's something that I was actually told. And I remember thinking, oh, that's right, that's hard for me. Think, what am I gonna do? And then I remember thinking, that's insane. And I just kind of, you know, I am 50% Chinese and I'm also a lot of other things, but I am me, and I just wanna be cast for me, which just encompasses a lot of other things. And thanks. And it was something where I felt a little guilty about it, but I also, you know, knew that I would make a difference. And I was like, I'll make sure that other girls don't have to do that anymore. That other, like, Chloe Wongs are not gonna have to do that. And in Chinese culture, you know, your father's last name is really important. So my dad's first name is Bennet. So that's where Chloe Bennet comes from. And I booked the first role after I changed my name, by the way. The first thing I booked.
Right.
Which is insane, which is crazy.
Right.
And I don't know how I feel. I have mixed feelings about it now.
Mm.
But it's my journey, it's the path I took, and, you know, I'll own it now. But I do have mixed feelings on doing, making that decision. Yeah.
Camila, I read an interview that you gave where you talked about early auditions when you were told you were not
Latina
white enough or not urban enough or whatever.
I've always kind of lived in this in-between of just being like ethnically ambiguous, like what is she? And in my first year of auditioning after I got an agent, I was just, I kept going out for Latina roles, but I was never booking them because their idea of what a Latina looked like was more urban, as they love to say. And it's like, I always felt like the whitest person in the room. And I, you know, when you're in New York too, the auditions you go for, they're like these kind of, it's like underprivileged, you know, like you're going for shows like Blue Bloods and like, you know, all the other crime shows that shoot in New York. Yeah. And I was like, look, I'm Latina, I'm Brazilian, I'm not Dominican, but I'm Latina. Okay. And I felt like I didn't have a place in this industry either, because I'm like, well, if I'm not white enough and I'm not Latina enough, then where do I fit? And also, why do I have to be fit your idea of what a Latina looks like if I'm, like what you said, I'm fully Latina, like both parents, fully Brazilian, I'm Brazilian. Can I just play Latinas, please?
But isn't that so frustrating? It's like, who is at the other end of that question?
Yeah.
You know? And I mean, what is it like to be almost asking those questions of whatever it is, whatever, you know, sexist or racist or marginalizing question that is being asked about you? And do you just want to just like, where do you go? Do you go anger? Do you go like, I'm going to change this?
I think you just, sometimes it's, unfortunately, for me at least, it just got lucky because when they were casting Riverdale, they made Veronica Latina. And you know, when they first released the breakdown, I figured she was gonna be like a white girl with dark hair, like she is in the comics, like a pinup type. So I completely didn't think I would even go out for it. And then I saw that they were making her Latina and I was like, wait, I could actually, like this can work. And they weren't even trying to like force this heritage on her, like, ooh, she's Latina. Like,
you were just right for the role.
Yeah, exactly.
You were her.
And I was Latina and that's enough. You know what I mean? Like, you don't need to hit it over the head and like kind of, I feel like a lot of times now people are trying to like fill quota or, you know what I mean? Like they're trying to just like force diversity to make a point instead of just being like, we should just embrace diversity and play these characters because we deserve to.
Yeah. I have a question about Veronica. And in some ways before the show came on, because I read the comics and stuff, I was afraid that the show would equate strength with bitchiness.
Right.
And thankfully, and they most definitely have not, and did not, even though we've all seen that a billion times.
Yeah.
I'm curious what the conversations were like that you had with the producers, or if that ever came up.
Wasn't necessarily a conversation. I feel like our showrunner Roberto just wanted that to be the case from the start. I mean, especially when you're, you know, it's like Veronica's a lead character, they can't make her someone that you're gonna hate, you know what I mean? So we wanted to make her nice for several reasons, but I mean, in the comics, she's just a spoiled rich bitch, and they're just like fighting over Archie the whole time. That's the entire storyline for Betty and Veronica, is them wanting to date Archie, who's kind of useless. And it's like, why? These women are so great, why do they want him? And then another thing that was really great with our version of these characters is that they're not fighting over a man, and they have their own independent storylines. And they're women that support each other kicking ass. You know what I mean? Like they're very, there's never a moment in the show, I mean there's conflict, but most of the time Betty and Veronica are a duo and they lift each other.
And there's an especially moving moment I think on the show this year with Veronica fighting off a sexual predator, which I think was hailed by critics and fans and so many people who saw it as so important.
Yeah.
I'm curious what that was like.
I mean, I got to punch someone in the face. It was really fun. I don't get to do that a lot. But yeah, that message is super important. If you guys don't know, there's an episode where basically this guy tries to molest me and ends up roofing a girl and taking her home. And we realize he's taking her home and you like run in, me and like all the pussycats. We run in and we just beat the shit out of him. Like we all beat him up at the same time. And it's like a small story, but it's like, it's a big thing to see that, to see like four women taking down this rapist.
Yep.
I mean, it's a heavy thing, but I'm glad we have an audience that's appreciative of that.
Yeah, absolutely. Chloe, obviously the world is getting better for superheroes who are women. We've got the Wasp out now, Captain yes. Marvel, obviously Quake, come on. And yet you still hear that term, strong
don't
female.
Say it, oh hero. God.
I don't know, I don't know how, because you know, I've been in Comic-Con now, this is my sixth year, and every year I sit in these hotel suites with a lot of interviewers, and you know, I get asked this question, like, what's it like to play a strong female character? I'm like, why don't you ask the guys what it's like to play a strong male character? Well, I would have never heard that, and I don't know how I feel about it, because I don't know if it's opening up the conversation, or if I, you know, people should ask more of a dynamic question. Does strong mean strong or strongly written? You know, because there's strength in being vulnerable, there's strength in being empathetic, there's strength in a lot of different things. And I think it should be asked, like, what's it like to play a real character, a woman that, you know,
a complex woman.
A complex and is, you know, authentic and has her own motivation and isn't a catalyst for the male on the show. And that's the, you know, that's what makes my character dynamic, because she has serious moments of weakness, and the biggest thing is, you know, I think it, flaws are really important to have in characters, especially that are women, because you don't, it's just dynamic. I mean, it's just, I don't know, it's just a weird question. I don't know if it's an insult or not.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
I feel like it's a tricky line that we walk as marginalized actors, because we have this large conversation about representation, and we want that representation to exist. We want strong female characters, we want black characters, we want Asian characters. But there's this awareness that I have, at least, that part of the reason why I'm able to create representation is because of the level of accessibility that I have. Mm-hmm. And there's a part of that that is not in alignment with what I believe in terms of, we do this playing the game thing where we know that we're contributing to a system that perhaps we don't fully believe in, but at the same time, it's worth it to sacrifice some of that in order to create the representation that we want to see.
Absolutely, it's a give and take in a lot of different ways, and it can be very difficult.
Yeah, it's challenging, and so I think it requires us to have this high degree of self-awareness as we navigate our careers, knowing that there's a certain amount of privilege in whatever form our identity takes that allows us to create that accessible, maybe sometimes corporate version of whatever identity we want to be represented. But at the same time, it's like we have to do it, because then it opens up potential doors.
Yeah. Jodie, how is that for you, navigating this new world that in a show that was largely staffed by men and certainly starring mostly men?
Yeah, and it's a really unusual role for any actor, because you're playing an alien. So, you know, there's no rules. So obviously being the first female to play that, I appreciate the moment, and I'm proud of the moment, but I also can't wait for the moment to go. So that it's, you know, like I say, we don't, if we all sit on this panel in 5 years, will we be having the same conversation?
Right.
And hopefully not. But I don't disregard what this means, because it means a lot to me. You know, for anyone who doesn't know the show, there's a doctor, and they have friends, you know, known as previously assistants, often played by women, and then companions that were played by women and men, obviously. And then with our kind of version of this, we've got three friends, but there was no part of me as an actor would ever think I would be auditioning for the doctor, because the doctor's played by a guy. But why? Like, it's as soon as you've said it and you've cast me and all the things, I'm like, you're a girl? I'm like, yeah, but you know what? I can play an alien. So I've probably got as much like on my CV to qualify me as, for that as any of the other guys. So I think we're all pretty, you know, none of us have really come out of alien school, so I think we're all able to do it. But it is a unique part for that, because you talk about, like you say, strong women and things like that. I realized I was finding these lines are a lot of them bonkers, but it's really hard to learn the amount of dialogue that, you know, when we are so lucky to play a lead, you know, you have all this dialogue for us, and it's, you know, it's loads. But then I realized sometimes I find it hard, I think, because for a long time I was just answering a question in a scene. So I never led the scene, I never started the dialogue, or had the balls to take the conversation in a different direction when other people are talking about something. And I think, right, okay, so I need to, that's depressing. but you know, it's not the case for every show, of course it isn't, it's not the case for every film. It just, sometimes you get into the mindset of, well, I can learn my lines, because actually I'm just waiting for the question that's going to be my cue to answer that question from that other character has more to say. And, you know, now, hopefully, this panel will be around, but it will be full to the end.
Yeah. Is Time Lord a gender-neutral term?
Is Time Lord?
Yes.
Yeah. Definitely. It's not a time lady.
Regina, when we were thinking about the title of this panel, Women Who Kick Ass, I feel like you have kicked my ass so many times with the characters you have played, because they're so good and so intense. Anyone who's seen, like, I'm curious, what is it, the thing where you feel like, that's a character I have to play? And the flip of that, if you feel like, this is a character I'm never gonna play.
Sure. Definitely goes both ways. For me, I just look for truth in the story. Whether it's comedy, whether it's drama, it has to be rooted in truth. And if I feel like, I think it's actors, one of the things that we do, even though we're playing different characters, what makes a character or makes a performance believable is when the actor has been able to find a bit of themselves in that character. So that's where the truth comes, and I need to feel the same way about what it is that I've written. You know, when I put it down and I'm like, oh, yeah. That made me feel all types of stuff. That's the piece I want to be a part of, whether it's one scene or several scenes. Mm-hmm.
And you're obviously, excuse me, directing now, and I'm curious, for the rest of you, is there a different feeling on set when you have a woman director?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Tell me.
Absolutely. I mean, I just recently, I've said this in another panel, I directed the finale of Insecure, and thank you. My DP was a woman, and my first AD was a woman.
Ooh.
So the three of us were just like some badass broads feeling like, you know, I said the Holy Trinity. We were just like, it was so empowering. And there was a shorthand with our communication, I think, just because we could recognize those moments that are tense and how to navigate for each other, with each other. And I think that happens as an actor when I'm working with a female director. Unfortunately, there's only been like four female directors in my 30-something year career that I've worked with.
That's
ridiculous,
yeah.
You know?
Well, 28% of TV directors are women. That's an alarming number.
Right. And how many women are in the world?
Right.
Right. It's crazy. But I definitely feel like when I've had those moments being directed by women, again, I feel like there's this shorthand that's there. There's this sensitivity that's there in a powerful way. I think it's, you know, we use the words, I'm always leery about using the word sensitive along with woman, because so often it's thought of as a negative when actually, usually with sensitivity, I think of love and leading with love. So maybe that's what it is. I'm feeling more of the love. So I'm gonna take sensitive back and say, I feel more love.
How about for the rest of you? Do you feel a difference when you're being directed by a woman?
But I think,
absolutely.
Yeah, no, I was just going to say, I'll be really quick. I'm like, I've been lucky enough to be directed by women, but the percentage is terrifyingly small. And it's always been, you know, incredible. And I think you sum it up with that sense of, it's the like choice of word, isn't it?
Yeah.
So sensitive. But then it's like, oh, what does that mean now? And, but yeah, come on, your answer is yes.
I've had the privilege of working with three female directors in a row. I don't know how that's happened.
Yeah.
But I feel very honored. Hopefully it gives you some hope. And something that I've noticed is that I think men have this notion that power is gained through dominance, whereas women understand that power is gained through allowing the space for trust. And I think that's what female directors do. They allow the space for trust. They allow the space for people to do their best work and allow it to be collaborative, so that instead of people doing what they're told to do out of a place of fear, they do it out of a place of wanting to contribute to something larger than themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it's everything about it is different. It's nuanced. It's different the way the crew is. It's different, you know. It's different the little, you know, because I play such a badass character, and I constantly have to fight. Not fight. I constantly fight with myself to make sure that those moments aren't just me acting more stereotypically masculine. I want her to kick ass in the most feminine, beautiful way possible, and like it, her to be vulnerable, and that to me is strength.
Right.
And so that's, and I love hearing feedback. It's jarring when you have a woman and they whisper something to you that you've never heard before, and you go, oh my God, that makes so much sense. I connect with you. You get so used to having to explain yourself to men a lot, and it's just nice. There's a shorthand. You just have. Less work.
Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting when you think about words like sensitive or vulnerable, words that, you know, just taking those words and reframing them as positives, even though society tells you that those are negatives.
Yeah.
I feel like it's fearlessness. Like, to be vulnerable is to be fearless.
It's terrifying to be
vulnerable. Yeah, like you're putting yourself in a vulnerable situation because you're like, you feel strong enough to handle whatever is going to come back at you. So I've never seen vulnerability as a weakness. I think it's the biggest strength.
Well, it's the very definition of an actor, being vulnerable.
Yeah,
that's exactly. What
and I feel like to like avoid out. Being vulnerable is to be weak.
I agree.
To acknowledge the fact that you can't handle the truth, or you can't handle putting yourself
really
out there. Yeah, exactly.
Was there a piece of advice that someone gave you as you were either embarking on your career, or something that is stuck out? Regina, for those of us who started watching you in 227, I'm really hoping your answer comes from Marla Gibbs, but go with anyone.
Gosh, Marla is everything. I learned to be a professional working with her every day. I guess the best advice that she gave me so much was that when the camera is not on me, to give just as much to the actor when the camera's on them, because it makes everybody's performance better. And I really didn't understand what she meant like about that, because at that time I was in an environment where all of the actors were doing that. So when I, after 227, and I started working on movies, you know, noticing, you know, the cameras, some of the person that's the biggest star, they're doing their coverage first, and you know, they're like kicking ass, and then turn the camera on me and they'll turn like into Michigan J. And I'm like, wow, this is what she's talking about. But she's like, who the hell is Michigan J?
No, not that. I'm like, that's so depressing.
I know. Yeah.
I've been like,
I won't say any names.
No, no, but, yeah. I've never.
Yeah.
Oi!
Yeah.
Oi!
Yeah. Yeah.
Still here. Out there. Yeah.
And it's funny that happened. And then I work on Jerry Maguire with Tom Cruise, and he was just so lovely. And I just want to give him his props, because I was expecting to have another version of that, and it was time for my coverage, and he left the set, And I was like, yeah, here we go. You know, he's probably gonna have his stand and read lines for me. And he just went to go clean off some of his makeup so he could come. He was like, no. I'm here for you. And I was like, so it's great. It was great to know that you can be that big and not forget where you're from. Because I think there's a lot of those actors that I'd worked with prior to that moment probably were initially off camera given it. But, you know, success brings laziness sometimes.
How about the rest of you? Any words of wisdom?
Mae Chinamek, who plays Betty's mom on the show, and who was in Twin Peaks. So she, you know, she went through her whole moment when Twin Peaks came out. And she, like right before, the day before our show came out, she told me and Lily, because, you know, we're playing these best friends on the show and we're two leading females. And like, she was like, people are gonna wanna put you two against each other. They're gonna wanna compare you constantly. And they're gonna try to just make you guys hate each other, you know, because we're different, you know? And I realized that like I start to see that, you know, like everywhere, every comment you read, people are like, the blonde's hotter, or like, you know, everyone's kind of making those comparisons. And Mason was like, don't let the media mess up your friendship. Like, you guys have such a beautiful friendship and you're different. Different opportunities are gonna come to you because you look different, you act different, you talk different, but don't use that as a means of making one feel lesser than. You know, you guys can both exist equally and have successful careers, and they're gonna go in different directions. At some point, one of you might have more attention than the other, but never let that get in the way of your friendship, you know, and your support for each other. And I thought that was super valuable because I think we're always taught as women to compare ourselves to other women.
Yeah.
And it's harmful. It just kind of messes up the dialogue.
Any other words of wisdom that you got along the way?
It was more of an observational thing. So when I was, I don't know how long ago it was, I feel like I'd just left drama school. I was really lucky and I got a job on a show in the UK that has all of our kind of greats in it. And I was sat on set in a massive circle and everyone's on chairs, just having new cups of tea in between takes. And there was probably 12 cast members, you know, one of which was Judi Dench, and the other one was, you know, Imelda Staunton, and we had just this kind of, and there was me and another actress, Michelle Dockery, and we were just kind of sat there, and we were a part of this circle. No one was in a trailer hiding. Everyone was chatting and talking about anything and everything. And I thought, if Judi Dench, if you're my number one on set, and I can sit next to you and have a cup of tea, and actually be included in this circle of actors, so because we're all doing the same job, and you know everyone on the crew's name, you know everyone, and it's not because you've ever shouted at anyone, it's just because you're ace and you're lovely, and we like sat there and we're like, yeah, this is, you know, this is for us. How ace is it going to be when, because, you know, we'd gone to drama school together as well, so for us, like in, you know, however many years, if we're sat there on a job back again with people we've collected on the way because we've worked with them, and we're all sat chatting to, I suppose, the next generation of actors in that open-hearted sense where it's a real conversation and it's no effort and there's no ego and there's no hierarchy. I just thought that's how to be on set, is to be everyone's mate. Because nicer things happen when we are a team. And like you say, there is such a weird thing that we would, that the sisterhood or the actresses don't get on or aren't. Like, who made that up? Because we do, you know, we've all just met. And it's been a lovely, hilarious chat on the stairs down there. There's none of the thing that we're kind of told to be. It's like, it ain't like that, and it doesn't have to be. And we shouldn't ever let it be, and we won't. So hopefully that is then carrying on from the greats that came before.
I'm curious, you know, and it's similar to Chloe, what you were saying about that thing about what's it like to play a strong female or whatever, or saying, you know, that misconception that, like, oh, put two actresses in a room, there's going to be drama or whatever. What are your other pet peeves that you see, sexist pet peeves going on, either in, like, scripts you've written or, like, stuff that goes on set that you're like, ah.
I know.
We'll be here for 6 hours.
I notice a lot of just this assumption that women are not capable of doing like very basic physical activities for themselves in scripts. That bothers me.
98% of the saving on my show is done by the females. We're the most powerful people on the show. And what I love about S.H.I.E.L.D. is that they just do it because it's real and they don't really talk about it. We don't, it just is, you know, we don't promote it because of that. It just is, which I love. But yeah, that's always, it's always interesting going into a stunt rehearsal and, you know, sometimes there'll be new stunt guys and they're like, oh, honey. And I'm like, oh, honey, calm down. So you kind of have to, and then you proceed to do really well. And they're like, wow, you're pretty strong. And you're like, thanks, George, you know, right? It's that kind of thing. The assumption, I love being in meetings and, you know, express myself. And then, you know, you have the guys sit back and they're like, you know, you're pretty smart. And you're like, oh my God, thanks. Like, thank you so much. Now I feel smart because you validated me, sir. That's always so funny.
I have a thing that I've said about a million times to everyone in my life that just winds me up is, oh, you've got a really good throw. You throw like a boy. I don't. I throw like me. Yeah. And I'm not a boy.
Yes.
I throw like someone who stops to throw a ball.
Yeah.
But thanks for the compliment. I'm like, and everyone's so bored of me saying it. It's like, really, that's your big thing? It's not my big thing. Of course it's not. There's millions of things bigger. Yeah. One of them, it really winds me up.
Exactly. Yeah.
I feel like a lot of people here probably know about the S.H.I.E.L.D. test, but I'm tired of seeing a lack of plot lines between women that have nothing to do with men. Like, I want to see women being friends. I want to see women being lovers. I want to see women being sisters and having relationships to each other and discussing things that have nothing to do with anything that will serve a male plot line.
The one I'm choosing to use is similar to that. I developed a pilot that didn't get picked up, but it was starring 5 black women. They were all NYPD officers based on real women that are sisters in the NYPD. And as we're developing the script, one of the notes we got for one of the husbands of the cops was that, he really doesn't have anything to do. He's just kind of answering what she's saying. And we were like,
oh, no.
Well, isn't that what the wife does all the time in your show?
What will that guy do?
How will he survive?
That's what he is. He's the husband.
Yes.
No, we're not changing it. And we stuck by that. Didn't get picked up, but we stuck by it.
Yeah. And the next one will.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Since we are here at Comic-Con, I'm curious, I don't know if you've been out and what it's been like to see people dressed up, see cosplay of you guys and of your characters. What is that feeling like?
Well, and no one's seen my character yet. Like, hopefully sometime next year, I'll see quite a few of me's walking around.
Can you say anything about Watchmen?
I cannot. All I know is I'm wearing a wristband representing us, and hopefully I'll tell you guys about it next year, or you guys will have seen. But it's very cool because the first time I was at Comic-Con was like almost 14 years ago for Boondocks, and that people found me in this whole city with Boondocks paraphernalia. Like, that's, and the show hasn't been on for years, so just the devotion that Comic-Con fans have is just the coolest thing. I mean, part of me wishes I could just like put on a mask and just sit and watch the cosplay all day just on Sixth Avenue, just taking it in. It's really, the dedication is amazing.
What's so moving about it all, I find, is that, you know, we were lucky enough to kind of like walk out onto the floor, and there was the kind of by the Doctor Who stand, and there was the cosplay for, you know, it's like you, our season hasn't come out yet, and there's people dressed as the Doctor, and it can be that costume is just the Doctor's costume. It's not referenced to anything other than that character, so it doesn't mean if you are a guy or a girl or from wherever you are in the world that only you can wear it. It's like you're wearing a costume, and that's what I love, the celebration of fandom and the celebration of your heroes. And anyone can be their hero here, and that's brilliant. And you know, I think the next thing will be is if I ever walk down the street and see someone just dressed as the Doctor randomly, not in Comic Con, that'll be a real high.
That's coming.
That might end.
Chloe, I know you've seen yourself out here.
I know. I've seen a bunch of quigs this year too. It makes me emotional every time I, especially, you know, young girls and boys, and there's such a power in a costume and clothing and how you present yourself. And to see, you know, young people or old people, people of different colors and shapes, like, feel empowered, that's just so amazing. It's at the point where, because I have a really heavy hand in the design of the suit, and like, they're super lenient with that and they're super collaborative on the show. So I always make sure it's something that is accessible for fans to make. Now I'm in the fittings. I'm like, well, this will be easier for people to cosplay. So I want to make sure that people are able. I really, really do. Like, it's almost like they're like, Chloe, but this is the show. Like, we gotta do. Because in reality, is those? I'm just gonna say, they're so uncomfortable. Like, superhero suits are. It makes no sense. I can't move. I really can't move very well. They don't breathe.
Then, oh my God, I lost inches.
Yeah.
I can't afford to lose inches.
No, it's like just sweat. It doesn't leave. Like, I'll take off my pants and it's just sweat. It's just crazy. But yeah, it's been amazing. It's been amazing to see young girls and I've seen a couple boys dress as Quake, which is awesome. And it's just inspiring. It's really cool. It's really cool.
If you could dress up, if you could cosplay any character, comics, movies, TV, book, anything, what would you do?
Well, I've got to change. I got asked this the other day. So for anyone who was in the panel the other day, I said sloth. So I'm going to change it from Goonies. So I'm changing it now. I would love to totter around as E.T. Yes. Or ideally, someone would ride a bike and I'd just sit in the front.
Yeah.
Basket. And then just be taken around. Like the star I am, I don't even walk. That big a deal. That's what I do. Oh, so, is any more really classy, mature answers coming?
Did you say you said sloth?
Sloth in the panel for
clothes. ET is clothes. That's a nice.
Same.
Oh, nice.
How about the rest of you?
Does anyone play Telltale games? Yeah. Shout out. I wanted to cosplay this year, but I don't have time, but I wanted to cosplay Clementine from The Walking Dead. Oh,
gosh. I don't know. I guess I'm about to show my age again. It would probably be, because it was a cartoon that I loved when I was a kid, so it would probably be like Firestar from Spider-Man and His Amazing Friend.
No one's heard of it.
Because I'm in the costume so much, I just want to be comfortable. Yeah. Like, what's the most comfortable cosplay? Like, I don't know.
Is there a superhero in sweats?
No pants.
Yeah, like, they should wear sweatpants. I feel like you really would get the most done, because you're the most mobile.
I don't want to rub it in, but my costume is really comfy.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh, so jealous.
It's really comfortable.
You can run about, it doesn't pull, I don't sweat.
They're all practical, that makes more sense. Maybe really Jean Grey. Maybe Jean Grey.
Yeah.
Or Hermione, that's a rope, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
How about you, Camila?
I've been like sitting here thinking. I honestly, I feel like I don't want to
toad from Mario Brothers.
But like a cute toad, like a sexy toad. Toad, but make it fashion.
Can we come back next year?
Yes, yes. Well, you just told everyone, so now you'll be able to walk to the floor. But yeah,
see five slots.
Nothing to see here. Well, I just want to thank all of you. This has been so wonderful. I am inspired by all five of you in so many ways, and I know everyone is here too. Camila, Chloe, Amandla, Regina, and Jodie, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you guys. Thank you so much.